Afternoon, good evening to everyone out there, and welcome to the Tenable Cloud Security Coffee Break. I'm John Tonello, and I'm happy to be joined today by Tom Croll, who has the beautiful mountains and behind him. And Tom, you're not actually in the Alps or the Andes or wherever that happens to be.
Not today, John, not today. No, I'm originally from Scotland. I am based in London at the moment. Happy to be here. So
I can't tell by your accent, or is it me? Do I have the accent? Some background on Tom. He's an advisor with Lionfish Tech Advisor, and he's a former Gartner analyst. And we spent some time at KubeCon last year, which was an interesting time. And I think it was the first time that Tenable was at KubeCon as a vendor. And we had quite a few people coming up to us like, hey, you know, I love Nessus. What are you guys doing here? We had the cloud story to talk about and CSPM. We're also joined today by Paul Anderson, who has my name on his thing. So, but he's the Ali to my Stan, I guess I could say. That's how I like to think of Paul. For those who are as antique as I am, Paul is a sales engineer and all around good guy. He's also in the mountains today. Hi, Paul. You want to say a word?
A word or two. Your very kind introduction. Thank you, John.
Paul and I have a past working experience. I'm not going to say we have a past because, you know, it's not that kind of show.
What happens in Vegas stays in Vegas, John.
what happens in Provo stays in Provo. I'm excited to have both Paul and Tom on because they have deep experience sort of across the board, not just in security, but yeah, they have pretty good chops that way as well. And before we get into our first poll, which is me always asking what we are drinking, just a couple quick words about the topics today. It's all about cloud security posture management, also known as CSPM. We're going to talk about the what's, why's, and wherefores, and we'll take some opportunity throughout this hour to show you a few demos and some other stuff like that. I want to encourage all our attendees to weigh in with questions or their experiences or their war stories. That's part of the joy of the coffee break. And with that, I'm going to use that as a segue. If I can get my mouse to work today, it's not really doing its thing. What's your beverage? It is the coffee break, but we don't insist that you're on coffee. I personally am I'm a morning Folgers guy.
I'm a caffeinated, can't quite see with my camera. Anyway, caffeinated soft drink.
Yes. We added a couple other things like highly caffeinated soft drink, Red Bull, which is pretty interesting. You know, our coffee, I have my college age daughter living with us, and she makes coffee for herself before she goes off to school, but only makes half a pot. So
That going to do? It's not going to make a dent.
Right. I don't know what you're drinking, Tom. I know what you have drunk in the past.
It's later here than it is for where you are, but I'm past my coffee stage. I'm just on the water, and it's not quite beer o'clock yet, but it is 4 o'clock where I am in the UK. So
right. So I'm just going to share the results here. Coffee is always the big thing. We have a couple of tea drinkers and the caffeinated drinkers like Paul. So as we kick off here, and you know, just as a quick aside, Tom, water at 4 o'clock is okay. You're entering a window of I think it's universally known as happy hour. So not asking any questions. We're going to talk now, like, what is CSPM? And I have to admit, before coming into the security world, and someone who was familiar with, on-prem and cloud-based instances and stuff and scanning those things, the cloud, the AWS's, Azure's, GCP's, and others of the world have their own environments that are very different. I look at it, and I'll have Tom and Paul weigh in, as, understanding and mitigating the risks in those environments, not just the things that are running on them, because it's a whole different world. What's your take? What's your elevator pitch, Tom, on how you...
Well, one of the last papers I wrote at Gartner was Cool Vendors in CSPM. So I'm very familiar with the subject, and I co-wrote some of the initial research on cloud native application protection platforms, which is basically CSPM and CWPP, or cloud workload protection platforms. And CSPM has evolved from being this noisy configuration monitor that tells you to tidy your room, right? This security group's open, this key needs rotated, without giving you real context. And CSPM these days is telling you, what are my most important vulnerabilities that I need to remediate? It's not just this misconfiguration noise generator that we take in security operations and throw them over to the quite often the wrong team. We want to see, what are the misconfigurations present in your environment? What are the highest risk, and how do I remediate those? And ideally, we would facilitate that remediation by giving some code snippets and evolving that way. But at its basic core, it monitors a control plane and gives you insight into your cloud security posture infrastructure.
Right. And I would have Paul weigh in on, the differences between sort of the cloud security piece and maybe instance or actual, what we might call runtimes or VMs, where are we bridging there, right? We're not just scanning the stuff that's doing the work.
Absolutely. So I think when you were introducing me, you asked me to say a word. My background is actually in infrastructure. And so I come at this from a little more of an infrastructure point of view, the idea that if you're standing up, provisioning a traditional physical server, provisioning maybe a virtual machine in a data center, there's the combination of what's running in the operating system, and then there's the combination of all the other stuff. And so, for instance, how it's cabled, what is it cabled to, how is it, how are the firewalls configured, what are the various BIOS settings that might affect security, things like that. And so as you're looking at your overall, how do we want to secure this infrastructure, as you move into the cloud, all of those things get virtualized, right? We're not plugging in cables anymore. We're not, dealing with appliances and things like that, the way that we would in a traditional data center. So being able to see not only the misconfigurations as well as the vulnerabilities, to me, is something that gives you that more complete picture of your entire infrastructure, the threat landscape that you're looking at. Because if you're only looking at this from a vulnerability perspective, it could be that attackers have other ways to wheedle into your infrastructure, not just exploiting, the latest zero day.
Right. And the question nowadays, of course, because people are still running on prem systems or thinking of those infrastructure things. And I don't think there's a real equivalent, is there, to, I have an on-prem data center, that's a physical place, and you push around a cart and you pull Cat 5 and 6 cables and do all that kinds of stuff. Are there any similarities to that when it comes to these cloud environments, which are super complex and have, virtualized everything that used to be physical?
Well, we certainly can't run the equivalent of CSPM to run around our data centers for us. But the cloud gives us that unique API-based source in order to pull out all of these configurations, which, I mean, in a virtualized data center, sure, we can do some of that, but we can't scan the entire security posture of our infrastructure on-prem. That's one of the benefits of cloud and
cloud, right? You know, which leads to like why, and you answered some of the why of CSPM, and of course Tenable Cloud Security provides CSPM within the overall Tenable One, which, you know, knits together a whole broad array of tooling to do some of this stuff. But, you know, when I look at, okay, I have my cloud workloads, AWS has some tools there, and Azure has some tools, and Google has some tools. Why can't I just use those?
Well, the thing is, if you want to run multiple clouds, and quite often these vendors have said, yeah, okay, we'll give you CSPM for our environment, and now Microsoft's CASB could even reach into AWS and give you some CSPM. But at the end of the day, are you really going to trust competitors to give you the same level of service when monitoring multiple cloud environments? I mean, they might be doing that today, but what happens tomorrow when they decide that they're head to head? So in order to de-risk and to enable multi-cloud, I would heavily advise people, and I did this for years at Gartner, to go with a third party. If you've got one single cloud provider, okay, start with their native tools, that's fine. But we want to have a multi-cloud enabled or hybrid cloud enabled security tool set and mindset at the end of the day. So investing in a third party, it's the competition is with other third parties to be more enabled, to have more features, to be better across multiple clouds. You can pretty much guarantee that none of these third parties are going to suddenly give up on your cloud service provider because they need to stay in that market and stay competitive. That's the way I put it.
Right. And building on that just a little bit, you've also got the fact that each of the different cloud service providers has a very different way of looking at things. And so, you know, you literally need a Rosetta Stone to compare, okay, AWS calls it this and Azure calls it that, and GCP calls it this other thing, because each of them have, you know, their own particular view, their own marketing department, their own implementation. And so, so it can become very complex. If you're using one of those cloud service providers, you're also sort of accepting their outlook in the world, and this is how cloud should be, and they're forcing the other vendors to try to fit in that paradigm, which as Tom said, is kind of a recipe for risk.
Yeah, and I've seen multiple studies that show organizations that are using multiple clouds is, you know, growing every day for all the reasons Tom was talking about. You're reducing your risk, right, by spreading it out. But at the same time, it is a little mind-bending to go from the Azure dashboard to the AWS dashboard to the other dashboard. And not just a little mind-bending, but, you know, if you're doing that stuff, or you have an expert in your organization for one or the other, it's easy to actually increase your risk based on that person, but also introduce human error that because you're like, oh yeah, over here there's this thing I have to disable, because you know that never happens.
Do you want to have a specialist or need a specialist in all three of the clouds, or even four if you're in four clouds, or do you want to de-risk that by outsourcing it to a third party and having then make the abstraction? I think the other important point I wanted to make was the degree to which third-party tools can abstract, just building on Paul's point, abstract away the differences in terminology and the nuances and give you a normalized view across clouds is one of the biggest benefits of having a third-party CSPM or cloud security tool. It doesn't just say this security group's open in AWS, this network group's open here, and GCP has a completely different language. We can say, okay, these are your normalized risk views across multiple cloud providers. So I think that's one of the biggest values of having a third party interpret those for you.
And make it digestible. That brings us to our second poll that I'm going to launch here. Are you using CSPM? And you know, are you using a particular tool today? I'd also be, you know, would love to hear from our audience how that's going, and if you're using multi-cloud as part of that, and you know, what some of your concerns are. And while that poll is going on, I'm going to share a slide that I have here that I think I can do it. This is the anatomy of a $270 million cloud breach. I think Paul shared this with me. It's floating around, but it shows, you know, the attack path. The attacker is looking at something like a misconfigured firewall, gains access, moves laterally through the system, gains some access to credentials. Those credentials give them a capability to list the S3 buckets, and with that capability has the power to download post files, do some other nasty things. The blue bubbles there show, you know, specific CIS policies in this case, and people are using different frameworks for this. And being able to detect these various risks, not on just one platform, but on all of them, is really what we're talking about here. And with the poll, I'm going to share the results here. Few people are saying yes, some no, some don't know. And if you don't know, you're not alone either, because though CSPM itself and the name, I think, isn't a new idea, but it is newer. And if you're new to the cloud, or you're coming into more cloud use, it's something that comes up on your radar. Do the results surprise you at all, Tom?
If I wasn't using a cloud, I wouldn't need a CSPM. So I'm hoping some of that accounts. I'm hoping some of that accounts for the poll. One of the things we used to say is that over 99% of cloud data breaches are down to misconfigurations. If you're going to use one security tool in the cloud, make it CSPM. That's a quick win. It's read-only. It scans through your environment and shoots out some data for you straight away. You can do a proof of concept in one sprint or two sprints if you want to evaluate multiple providers. But if you're running any kind of cloud workloads that have anything that you want to protect in there, then you really need to be using a CSPM. Even like if you're just using AWS, start looking at Trusted Advisor and start looking at some of their internal tools to get an idea of the risk exposure that you have. As like I say, the configuration is the root of all breaches basically in the cloud, besides maybe the number of breaches I can count on one hand. So I would say it's a low-hanging fruit.
And one of the things I'm going to call on Paul and to bring up some of our dashboards here from cloud security, that's my hint to him. And if you don't have it, I do, Paul, but I'm sure you do. One of the keys of cloud security and CSPM is the ability to do continuous scanning, right? So, and scanning of what has become known as ephemeral things that come and go. And that continuous scanning means, okay, I'm always aware of everything you have, even though some of those things may last a couple minutes, a couple hours, a couple days. And I'm not just aware of the VMs, the instances, what's happening there, but that environment itself, right? Some of this stuff, you know, we might call it drift, which is a nice way of something changed, either on purpose, maliciously, or maybe there's a new problem out there that we need to solve, right? You could have 100% everything's compliant and everything's scanned and looks green, it's all go. And then, you know, you wake up in the morning, there's a new thing out there. And it impacts you and your resources. Do you want to pick it up from there, Paul, on some of the stuff from a continuous scanning and just observability perspective?
Absolutely. There is a message or a question that popped up. I'll go ahead and answer it. So if you have Tenable.io, Tenable CS, Cloud Security is licensed separately. But having said that, talk to your Tenable contact. There's probably something that can be done there. But yeah, to John's point, the cloud is something that tends to change quite frequently, right? Gone are the days of spinning up a new system and having it run uninterrupted for, you know, years and years. These days you're scaling out, you're scaling up, you're running, you know, if you're doing a lift and shift, then you're in the process of working with these systems in transition. And so being able to have that same level of understanding in an environment that's much more dynamic, much more ephemeral, much more subject to change, used to be that you could lock the door on the data center and have a reasonable amount of confidence that at least the core infrastructure wasn't going to change, even though someone might log into a system. These days, the infrastructure could change, the system could change, you could have more systems than you expected. Someone could spin up a virtual machine that's maybe not approved. There's quite a bit that can happen. So to your point, John, having an understanding of what's happening dynamically, being able to be aware of changes shortly as they've happened in a very low latency environment to understand what are these new resources that are spinning up? What are these new cloud accounts that got created? What are these new virtual machines that are stood up? Oh, these ones are expected because they're part of an auto scaling group. But these three over here, I don't know why, what happened there, and they don't have the tags that we're expecting. So I don't know, you know, which owner or cost center or you know, whatever spun them up. So I just have to track that down the hard way with a little bit of shoe leather. So having something that can continuously monitor this changing environment, as well as tie into the workflow, the more modern workflows of having, for instance, automation in your tool set. So when we see something, we want to create a ticket, or when we see something, we want to post in chat ops or send an email. That's pretty critical to the way that you have to work to do more with less, the environment we're tending to find ourselves in.
I wonder if you could click on the resources there, just some of the stuff that's being discovered within that cloud environment, and in your case, cloud environments.
Yeah, I've got a few. I've got a couple AWS and Azure accounts. I'm running Kubernetes. I've got several things going on. But as we talked about earlier, the abstraction, being able to understand things in plain English, let's look at our networking resources. Well, we've got a mix of AWS and Azure here, each of them kind of with their own, again, special flavoring, but it's easy to see where they are and what they're doing. So you can drill into these and say, well, let's talk about, for instance, the security groups, taking a look at this one, for instance, and getting an understanding of what is the misconfiguration on this particular group. Well, it turns out we're exposing MySQL a little high. So we've got the instructions on how to fix it. So it's all right there. And this is something that, as we mentioned, you can automate, you can put this into a pipeline, you can have alerting, you can open tickets. You can even, maybe there's a good reason for this particular circumstance. Maybe you've got some other control in place that makes this less of a concern. So you can go ahead and ignore this alert too, if that's appropriate in this case. So we're trying, oh yeah, go ahead.
No, all good. You bring up a key point in sort of dipping your toe into the DevSecOps world, right? Where you're talking about automation, that if you're using the cloud in a cloud native way, meaning, you know, you're throwing stuff up and you're throwing it away, you have cattle that way, that chances are good that you're using pipelines and build workflows. And you know, things exist not because someone went into a dashboard and created it in the cloud vendor. They automated it and it used a lot of stuff. Tom, maybe you could talk a little bit about how, you know, that approach links to CSPM, you know, for folks that are going fast and being asked to go even faster.
100%, John. Yeah, I'd like to chime in on a couple of those things. Paul, you mentioned tagging something that's badly tagged. That's an absolute nightmare. I've been in situations where we spent 10 weeks coming up with a tagging system and then it never gets implemented properly. So things spin up that's got no tag and you don't know who spun them up, who the ticket you should be assigning this to, which team. But when your CSPM has an infrastructure as code component, you can say, okay, we don't know who spun this up, but we can go back to the infrastructure's code, the code source, and look at the commit. And we can say that this person created this asset by using this code commit. So it's just to rewind maybe slightly for anyone who's not following, we're talking about making infrastructure as code. So you use like a CloudFormation or Terraform template to spin this up. You're not making it manually. So what we can do is we can link live assets back to the check-in at the infrastructure's code source code repository. And if it's not tagged properly, that's fine. We can say, we know that this belongs to you because your developer created it. So that's one of the advantages of having infrastructure as code tied to your CSPM capability.
Go ahead. That capability, because, you know, people that are using Terraform, they're using Puppet, Chef, they're using other tools. That stuff is the genesis of a problem, misconfiguration in that way. So if frequently what you're doing in a case like this, you know, you're finding, you're exposing these risks, you're doing, you're seeing all the resources. The solution isn't always going in and changing configuration from the dashboard. In fact, it's most often I'm going back to the code, I'm going back to the source and changing a configuration there. Paul, what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, it's so that's actually where my background is. I was doing infrastructure as code for quite a while as part of that that infrastructure gig that I've been doing prior to coming to Tenable. And yeah, it's absolutely amazing with respect to the idea that you can describe a very complex application, even a data center, if you will, in your infrastructure as code. And if you determine that there's some way of making it work better for you, it's just a matter of changing or tweaking an option, adding a little more configuration to tune it exactly how you want. And so it's really powerful, but a lot of organizations are at different stages of that journey. And so some of them are doing very manual configuration. Some of them have a combination where maybe some teams are doing development and other teams are doing it manually. I've worked with one customer, you know, a large healthcare industry, and they kind of ran the gamut where they had some systems that were, you know, very, very modern, very micro services oriented. Everything was done through a CI/CD pipeline and infrastructure as code. But then the people a couple cubicles over were, you know, manually caring and feeding for this one, you know, particular application developed early on that wasn't managed by code. And so to John's, you know, cattle versus pets reference, you know, sometimes the cloud does have pets that you have to treat a little differently. But one of the goals of Tenable CS is to help organizations on that journey to be able to more easily bring that infrastructure, that wild, wild west that you may have under infrastructure as code management, so that you can then more easily have that confidence of saying that we can audit the code, we can verify that things are the way that we expect. And if and when we identify a misconfiguration, we can then fix it in code and not have to worry about, well, you know, someone fixed it in the cloud, but then the developer redeployed it and that then misconfigured it again. And so then you have this concept that at least in the DevOps side, we call flapping, where it's fixed and then it's regressed and then it's fixed and then it's regressed again, because you have automation that's pushing these changes. And if you're pushing bad code, then you never quite know how long was this configuration out there before we fixed it. So that's why our view is looking directly at the code. But again, we realize that a lot of organizations are at many places in their journey on this DevOps, DevSecOps path.
Yeah, very, very true. And you know, when we talk about CSPM, there's some key points. You know, you want to be able to assess the risk. You want to remediate the findings and do some of that. I think, you know, all the assessing the risk and identifying what you want to see is a critical piece, right? Like, and it's not something that you necessarily start with any of these tools. It's you're sitting around the table or over a Zoom meeting and having conversations with folks saying, these are the priorities. These are the things we want to protect. These are the things that ultimately get coded into provisioning code that you were just talking about. Maybe Tom, you can talk a little bit about that process, because whatever you start with, you're always going to be sort of tweaking those policies that you want to be able to address, and then really, you know, curating that process all the way through to the running systems. But it begins with, hey, what's important to us? What do we want? What are our standards?
Yeah, sure. So it depends on what your risk appetite is and what you're comfortable running with, what your standards are. If you create infrastructure as code in the CI/CD pipeline that's non-compliant with your security standards, then either that's a flag to your security department that this application or this team needs some help with compensating controls, or maybe we need to adjust our standards for what we allow in our environment. So I mean, that's what I'm thinking about standards in general. You start off with a baseline, but you don't always have to adhere to best practice. The difference, the delta between best practice and your target state defines your risk appetite. So depending on the risk appetite you have for your business depends on what standards that you have. Does that answer your question? I'm halfway through typing a response to a question that came in here in the typed Q&A. So I hope that was correct.
Well, yeah, and you know, you bring up a great point. And I was talking with Glenn yesterday, our CTO, you know, about the broader Tenable One approach to helping customers understand what their risk is based on. It's not some sort of generic baseline, but based on what you are doing and what your risks are and what your workloads are, and you know what might be a high risk to me isn't a high risk to you, because not because you're not wise and sage, but because you've had those conversations. You know that these all have internal IPs and don't ever, you know, Facebook, whatever those things happen to be, right? So helping you establish what's really important for our particular thing. Yes, baselines can help get you started, right?
Yeah, So exactly, yeah. So we can go and look at the CIS benchmarks and say we need to be 100% compliant, but maybe we don't. Maybe we're looking at 80% compliance with the CIS benchmarks, and we've got a tolerance for X, Y, and Z. But at least we know what we're not complying with, or what standard we've decided we can accept the risk, or maybe we've treated the risk in some other way. So starting with a baseline of best practice CIS benchmarks, NIST, whatever it is, or even just Trusted Advisor or one of the CSP native tools, is a great starting point. And you might then, as Paul was saying, you might just decide to ignore certain misconfiguration because they're like, we've got an ACL around these virtual machines or these containers. So the fact that this firewall's open or this misconfiguration happens means that no one can actually get to that to exploit it. So you're gonna take a best practice baseline. And then you're going to look at, that was read yesterday. Okay, we need to do something about it. Okay, we'll ignore that. We'll deprioritize it. Or maybe we'll prioritize that for remediation. Get that into the backlog through the Jira integration or the ServiceNow integration that Tenable offers, and get that remediated as fast as possible. So yeah, your standards and your risk tolerance, or the way you configure these tools, is a fairly fluid process. But the best thing is to be informed by all the information that you can get. Is this exploit going to cause us problems? What's the actual risk here, or can we live with that? So yeah, everyone should attenuate from best practice in line with their risk appetite.
Exactly. And, Paul, I think, was showing before in one of his, as he was moving through the dashboard, the ignore, right? And in this interface, it's not just blindly ignore it. We actually build in the thing like, how long do you want to ignore this? What's your reason for ignoring it? Meaning you can revisit it and come back or permanently, or if something else changes, right? Some other thing. The integration too that you talk about, because if you're in the cloud, you're using workflows and automation to be able to trigger off that too, right? That something that you find not important shouldn't stop your build, right?
Yeah.
Shouldn't we always have to manually go in and do it. Like, now you want to be able to do that universally and have a central point that everybody can look at and go back to and go, oh, that's why we don't care about that. And it's not halting our process.
Yeah, ideally we put in guardrails and not gates. So we try not to block things from happening, but let's say there's a possible misconfiguration that gets checked in, and we can't really tell in the entire context from that small check-in of infrastructure as code. But we're saying, well, okay, this security group is exposing port 22. This may cause problems. You're fine to go and work with that at the moment, but this is going to have to be addressed either with a risk exception from the security team, or we're going to have to run some tests to make sure that there's an ACL surrounding it, just to take an example again, or there's a compensating control. I've got a question coming in here that I've selected to answer live, that how can Tenable help organizations that use multi-cloud comply with PCI DSS? Well, my answer to that always with any regulatory stipulation, I used to work for Visa, so we built PCI DSS, is if you conform to best practices, then you're most likely going to be in line with as many of these regulatory frameworks as possible. But we will call out, I think there's a page in Tenable One for Cloud Security where we say, okay, this misconfiguration means you are not going to align with PCI DSS. This misconfiguration means you're not going to align with NIST. This misconfiguration means you're not going to align with the CIS benchmarks. So there is a page for compliance. It will show you the possible vulnerabilities that are open, and then will help you prioritize the remediation by giving you like even code snippets and how you change that. So that's how I would say Tenable helps organizations with multi-cloud comply with DSS, PCI DSS.
Paul is showing that off, Paul.
Yeah.
All right.
So I've got your back, Tom. And
thank you.
And just highlighting the idea of multi-cloud, right? Looking at this particular section, this top one is all misconfigurations in my Azure environments. But here you can see these ones are a mix of AWS and Azure, ditto some of these other ones. So we do take that holistic view of your entire cloud infrastructure. And then yes, if there's a need to work through some of these, create exceptions, things like that, we can help you understand that in context and stop alerting, but continue reporting or kind of as appropriate there.
I was just going to add that organizations that have to adhere to regulatory frameworks like that, there's probably some folks in the organization that know that stuff backwards and forwards. But there's a whole bunch of people that are like, I don't know, Phil and Sue said that this was something and I have to do that. The power across multiple clouds within those specific frameworks, be able to go show me the specific ones, right? Because you're going to have a different auditor or your boss or someone come in and go, how do we look right now on this thing? And maybe that was because there was a breach in the news, there was something else, and there was something because and this goes back to that slide I showed, the anatomy of a $270 million breach. The costs aren't just, okay, we have to shut down our interfaces and our customers aren't able to, do stuff. But there are lawsuits and there are fines. Anybody working anywhere in, the GDPR zone of Europe knows very well. And I see very regularly, fines that are happening to companies. Is it a security risk by itself? Perhaps, but in that case, it's a regulatory misconfigure. You failed on that, which can also be costly in multiple ways.
Absolutely.
I'll just do a quick PSA and say, if you've ever looked at any of the GDPR fines, among others, the cost of a CSPM solution, and not just plugging our own, but any CSPM solution, is probably going to cost you a lot less than the fines are.
Yeah, I'm startled at those fines. I guess I'm old, but where a government fine used to be a few hundred thousand on something for things that affected life and limb often, it just gives you a clear picture of the seriousness of governments and companies and others in really enforcing certain practices that move beyond just security. Their intent is privacy and security, and there's a whole bunch of things in there. This kind of tooling does just that. And to Paul's point, very important, spend your money a little more wisely that way. I have another poll question here I'm going to launch because I'm curious, because we're talking about multi-cloud. We've been talking specifically about AWS and Azure GCP mostly. I'm curious from our audience, what you're using and are there others?
Oracle Cloud is quite gaining in importance. I'd just like to drop something in here. Hopefully this will be useful to anyone listening. All these privacy laws, as you guys say in the States, that are coming in all the time, GDPR is probably the strictest and the most mature privacy regulation that exists on the planet. And I always tell people, if you can comply with GDPR, then there's a good chance, as the conversation went with best practices, if you comply with GDPR, there's a good chance that you're going to be in a good position not to be the lowest hanging branch when it comes to being penalized by privacy laws that are being brought in the States and Canada, across the world. So I would always tell people, look at GDPR, look at some of those fines. I mean, there was 746 million euro or $886 million fine issued to Amazon in 2021. So this GDPR has taken its time to mature and it's starting to get teeth. So I would say that the fines are not insignificant. They're in multiple millions. It can be 4% of annual turnover. And the cost of a CSPM solution that protects you against some of those fines is, it's in perspective when you look at that. So comply with GDPR and you'll be in a good position.
Yeah, right. And, you know, across multi-cloud, it was interesting from that poll we just did, everybody in our audience said either AWS or Azure or AWS and Azure, a few using all the above, meaning AWS, Azure, and GCP. You mentioned Oracle. There's people taking advantage of AliCloud, I think it's called. I always want to say Alibaba, which is the company that runs on that. And there are other things as well out there if you're moving into a new geographic region, someone might say, hey, let's take advantage of this particular vendor and do that. And I think, you know, the advantage of having a third party tool means, you can bring in different regions, you can bring in different workloads from those different services all at once, see it unified, and ensure that your remediation is going everywhere and not, you don't have to repeat that. Remediation, Paul, you showed a few steps before. And I think one of the great things about basically all Tenable stuff from Nessus and the other products within Tenable One is the remediation recommendations. I like to think of myself as being pretty knowledgeable about tech, but there's a ton of stuff I don't know. And it's like having this, you know, angel on my shoulder going, hey, go into the dashboard, do this, and here's the code that you're doing. This is the spot in the code. I wonder if you could show some of that, Paul. And while he's setting that up, this has a broad implication, right? So you're doing it once, you're doing it early in your provisioning and security process, not much later. It's ultimately cheaper, but you are basically doing it once. Yes, your build pipelines may be different, but you're sending same code, the same remediation fixes through what I always like to say is the best process, which is a one way. You're not going back and forth. You're making those fixes. So I wonder if you could show off some of the remediation stuff and how it pertains to CSPM.
Absolutely. So while my slides are loading, I will point out that as I look at the survey, if I did my math right, 63% of the respondents are multi-cloud. And so having something that isn't tied to a specific cloud vendor is, I presume, important to them. But to answer your question more directly, let me take one step back. Let's talk about it at a high level, and then I will absolutely dive in and show kind of the detailed view of how we can help look at the code and help developers do a better job kind of from the beginning, so that you're not having to fight the fires in production. You're squashing the security issues prior to that. So this slide is intended to explain a little bit about how you might get started with Tenable Cloud Security. So traditionally, you've got security, we put them on the right, we've got developers sitting on the left. Usually the first thing that would happen with Tenable Cloud Security is we would get it configured with the desired security policy that you want to have in place. So PCI DSS was mentioned, CIS has been mentioned, NIST 853, SOC 2, whatever, those compliance benchmarks you're looking to adhere to, maybe you have some site-specific benchmarks. We've mentioned tagging once or twice, but we can absolutely ensure that not only security policies are being followed, but also business policies, making sure that you have an owner, you have a cost center, you have a disaster recovery prioritization. People use tags for all kinds of business reasons, not just security ones. And so those might be custom policies that are put in during this configuration stage. So usually the first thing or the next step would often be to connect it to the cloud runtime. And we'll let you know from a CSPM perspective how your cloud is doing. But then as we've been talking about, Tenable CS has tools that we can give the developer. So as they're writing this infrastructure as code, we can model it and we can compare it to the same policies that we're enforcing in the cloud runtime. So we can tell the developer, hey, you're about to unleash an unencrypted database. So you're about to create a world writable S3 bucket or whatever that hypothetical security issue might be. So the developer can then practice a little bit of self-care and make sure that their code looks good. We can also tie into CI/CD pipelines, part of the build process. So as that developer checks that code into Git, we can make sure that it's meets the standard, and upon security's preference or configuration, we can break the build. So maybe the developers are allowed to push insecure things into a development type environment, into a low environment. But if they try to push that same code into production, we'll break the pipeline and shut that down to keep it happening in the first place. So ultimately, what we're then trying to do is remove that toil and frustration and friction that both sides of the table feel, because neither of them have a complete view, neither of them have insight into, the developer doesn't really understand the security context, the security team doesn't understand why don't the developers just fix these things. And so ultimately through Tenable CS, we hope that we can help the security team adopt a more preventative posture by shifting to the left, having those things squashed before deployment. For the DevOps team, we want to have less unscheduled work, less rework, less toil, use their current workflows. And then at the top of the organization looking down, if you've got two teams that are performing more efficiently, then you've got those organizational benefits that you can start to bank on. You've also got a more holistic view of your cloud security because, like I mentioned, we've got that low latency constant monitoring. So as new things get deployed, you've got a really good idea, what did this just do to our security posture, or even a crystal ball to say, what is this going to do to our security posture if we deploy it? And then you also have that near real-time audit readiness so that you know how you're stacking up. So here's how this looks. This is an integrated design environment. This is Visual Studio Code. This is what a developer might write. Terraform code in, CloudFormation templates, some of that other infrastructure as code that Tom mentioned. Here, I've got a wide open CIDR block on line 16. So of course, Tenable CS detected that as a problem. And as a note, we're scanning 129 policies with a single violation. So the developer can then very quickly put something, oh, silly me, I need to not just use the copy pasta from the Terraform website. I need to actually edit it and adjust it for my particular environment. So they put in a more restrictive CIDR block, rerun the scan, and this time we're still running 129 scans. This time there's no violations. And we can, like I said, build this into a CI/CD pipeline. This happens to be Azure DevOps, but whatever you're using, we can follow the security team's requirements, and we can break builds that don't meet the security standards, and we can pass builds that do. And then the one last thing, and I see the time, I get really excited about some of this stuff, but this is an example of some source code that I'm using in my demo. And because we can integrate with that version control tool, we can actually let the developers know not just that you have a problem, we can actually write the Terraform code for them to let them know what they need to do to fix this particular issue. So for this particular misconfigured resource, we're generating 53 lines of code. And then the developer, in this case, it's AWS specific, the developer needs to put in an appropriate ARM. We can't know that off the top of our head, but if the developer just fixes that one line, we've written the other 53 lines, they can quickly test it, deploy it, and that will squash that particular misconfiguration. And so by shifting to the left, you can dramatically improve your MTTR statistics. And this ability to write code, this is also something that can help organizations that are maybe at the lift and shift stage and aren't quite at the cloud native development stage to bring some of that infrastructure under infrastructure as code. So I know I'm kind of excited about this, John. I talked about it quite a bit. Did I go the direction you're expecting, or did I go off on
that? No, perfect. And we actually have a question here. It says, can I see the issues in pipeline of issues over time and time to remediation? And I think you touched on some of that. And I'm not quite sure if the question is referring to, can I see how long it took us to remediate it or not? But that actually leads to our last poll that I'm going to ask while you do your thing.
So maybe I can clarify something. If you want to see the issues in the pipeline, issues over time and time to remediation, I don't know whether Tenable One CS does this, but I always tell people mean time to remediation and risk reduction, overall risk reduction, are far better measures than how many vulnerabilities did I find. And the way that I encourage people to build their tools is if you can plug in to ServiceNow or Jira as Tenable One can, and raise that ticket, create the user story, get it into the backlog, and have that story prioritized, then you're doing everything you can to take the blockers out of the way for that to be remediated by an agile DevOps team. So I don't know if we have a quantitative measurement of how this can be improved, but I do tell people you should run a POC in one sprint or two sprints and measure the mean time to remediation of before and after using this tool. And I guarantee you, if implemented correctly, a good CSPM tool will reduce that mean time to remediation. So it's kind of difficult to do that for every environment. So I think we've given you the tools to measure that. I think we'd measure that yourself.
Sure. Yeah, and perfect. See there's another question.
The poll, several days, a week, 2 weeks, and don't know. And the don't know isn't necessarily like, I don't know. It's, I don't know. We don't have a good way to track that. Several days is pretty good. But it's possible to do it in hours, right? And go ahead, Paul, we're just at the end, but the question was, please define shifting to the left.
Sure. So basically, because many of us speak Western languages, it goes from the left to the right. So the idea is that, left is earlier in the process and right is later in the process. So shifting to the left is the idea that we want to scan things, or we want to have confidence, reduce risk earlier in the process. So that would mean that, for instance, if we're scanning when a developer is writing their infrastructure as code, it might be akin to debugging an application prior to it being deployed in production. So if it's deployed into production, then you have to firefight, you have to, ameliorate it, whatever. But if the developer is ensured there's no memory leaks and there's no buffer overflows and those kinds of things, then you don't have to worry about it quite so much. So in this case, we want to make sure that the code defining the cloud infrastructure is error-free, misconfiguration-free prior to spinning it up, because there's no way to exploit code that, or infrastructure that doesn't exist yet.
Yeah, and in perhaps a more universal analogy is for a car recall, very expensive to fix something in a car through a recall, much cheaper to fix it in the factory. And so the shift left is the factory in this case. One last question here. Can I make the Jira integration allow for an approval before it goes on to dev then and verify it before they see it?
So the Jira integration as it works today. It will go ahead and open a ticket in the Jira project that it's configured to do. So making assumptions on how your Jira workflow goes, you could open it up in a project that, you know, the tickets get approved before being sent on to developers.
That happens in backlog grooming anyway, right? So the it goes into the backlog and the ticket gets created, assuming it's valid. Then they can close it off themselves and say, this is why we've closed it off, or they can prioritize it. But I think that that's usually a human process. That we've raised this ticket, you can't say you haven't seen it. And if you're going to close it, then we're closing it with this text saying, well, this is the compensating control. I think that, that you know, that the important part is getting those tickets into the backlog, and the backlog grooming process will take care of the approval process. Is that right?
We have one last question, and we're right at time, but it's a good question, so I'll add it on, and if you need to go, audience members, feel free. But the question is, can you please quickly review hardening of new assets? Is there any special process for hardening cloud assets with cloud security outside of what we've seen? And I think we've covered a lot of that, and you know, hardening is first, you can't secure what you can't see. So cloud security does a really good job of exposing every resource that you have and then telling you where the violations are and telling you how to remediate that. And those new assets, by the way, are, you know, ephemeral things coming and going. Something that emerged in a particular environment for you and your VPC, whatever it was, you'll know about it through this tooling. Anything you guys would quickly add to that?
Yeah, I'll just quickly say that the cloud is very flexible, so you can deploy things into a safe walled garden and run tests on it prior to deploying it in production. Tenable has a number of tools. We can scan Docker images, OCI images. We can scan hosts prior to them being deployed in production. There's quite a bit that we can do there. Talk to your Tenable resource, and someone such as myself would be happy to go into more depth with you on that topic.
Great. Well, thanks. We're going to have to wrap it up there. Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Tom, for joining us from the UK, where it's even closer to happy hour for you. I'm glad I could do that for you. And everyone who's been tuning in, thank you for joining us. Join us in 2 weeks for the next Cloud Security Coffee Break. Tell your friends, and we'll look forward to seeing you then.